next talk. Next, our moderator is Dr. Amol. He is a very hardworking, young, dynamic neonatologist from Apple Saraswati Hospital. Just by looking at him, you can recognize that he is very hardworking. Till now, he is sitting in his NICU, taking care of his babies. It's over to you, Amol.
Thank you, Prasanna sir, for this introduction. Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Shilpa Kalane. She has done her DNB pediatrics and she has done her DNB neonatology from KM Hospital, Pune. And she has done her observership in UCLA, USA. She is a consultant neonatology in Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital since last 5 years. And she's the executive member of Maharashtra NNF and she's the instructor for advanced and basic NRP. And we'll be specifically learning from her about perinatal and neonatal COVID. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Amol, for the kind introduction. At the outset, I would like to thank the Kolhapur Academy of Pediatrics for inviting me, as well as really thankful for the virtual hospitality which they have shared. I was very happy because since last 2 days, Dr. Prasanna was in contact. Madam, everything is good. You want anything. So that's really, you know, overwhelming. Thank you very much. So the previous three lectures have already covered majority important part of the COVID aspect in pediatric population, and that has really made my job easy. What I'm going to talk about is perinatal management of COVID. And as you know, we have been facing this COVID situation since March, and initial part, the discussion was whether the COVID exists in newborns or no, whether the mothers are affected or no, and how come mothers are spared, how come newborns are spared. So the part of the answer has been given by Dr. Rajan Joshi, sir. So by now we definitely know that the mothers are affected, though the manifestation varies from asymptomatic to severely symptomatic. Luckily, the fatality rate is low in mother, maternal as well as newborn population. However, the questions still, you know, major times are discussed are what is the route of transmission? What are the specific things we should take care of while resuscitating a newborn which is suspected or confirmed COVID positive? What respiratory care, special respiratory care should be taken in these patients, and any different feeding or discharge policy for these babies? So what I'm going to touch upon is basic the neonatal COVID manifestations, transmission, and the protocol which we follow in DMH before the COVID hit our country. So that was developed in March itself, and that's why it was easy for us to manage the COVID situation in perinatal period. So the incidence reported in literature is around 7% in babies who are less than 1 month. Now, I have not included the data from India. I have the unpublished data from India, that is from Indian Neonatal Collaborative of COVID, and which will get published soon. And DMH is part of this collaboration. Around the data has been collected from 10 to 15 centers across India. And the incidence of neonatal COVID, according to this data, is around 12.9%. It's pretty high. This is specifically newborns who are born to the COVID positive mother. The majority reports are from the government setup, partly 86% from the government setup. What is interesting is that the breastfeeding rates are pretty high in these patients. There are no isolation policies, not practiced routinely. And the symptomatic rate in newborns was around 1.5%. And those who were symptomatic, the pneumonia was the common presentation, that was 2.5%, and the severity of illness was less. The case fatality rate, which has been reported by this Indian data, is around 1.5% in neonates who are COVID positive. So this is a picture which shows route of transmission. So you can see there are three pictures. This is this tells you that if a mother is COVID diagnosed 14 days before delivery or 2 days after delivery, there's a high chance that she's going to transfer the infection to the fetus through the hematogenous spread, thereby the viral particles entering in amniotic fluid and the fetus ingesting the viral particle and the virus getting colonized to the nasopharynx. Now, this is called intrauterine transmission, which is also known as transplacental transmission or a vertical transmission. How do we diagnose that? you document that there is early exposure to the virus by doing the test at birth or as early as possible within 24 hours. The two type of test which have been discussed, that is RT-PCR of nasopharynx or COVID antigen test, or you could do cord blood RT-PCR, which is done in few centers. And you also document persistence of infection. Now this infection, if the swab is positive within 24 hours, it could be colonization. So you document persistence of infection by repeating the swab after 24 to 48 hours. That tells you that it is an intrauterine transmission. The intrapartum transmission, generally newborns would acquire either by exposure to the infected maternal blood or the exposure to the infected secretions or her feces. Is diagnosed if the baby is positive, COVID positive after 24 hours of birth, and if there are antibodies which are detected after 7 days, then it could be an intrapartum transmission. Immediate postnatal transmission, it is diagnosed when the newborn is positive for COVID PCR 48 hours after exposure, or 48 hours to 28 days after exposure, or the antibodies are positive around 2 to 3 weeks. So that is immediate postnatal transmission. There is some terminology called colonization. So where you will have the COVID test, which is positive, however, the repeat test would be negative. That's just a colonization. Hence, it is extremely important, the one who is doing the test, who is sending the nasopharyngeal swab for COVID PCR, that person is supposed to clean the baby at birth thoroughly so that there is no contamination. So what are the clinical features? So the newborns would basically be affected by three ways. One is maternal medical illness itself. Based on the severity of the mother, based on the trimester in which she is affected, the newborn is going to present in a different way. So if she is severely ill, like in any other medical illness we see in obstetrics, the newborn is going to get impact in terms of asphyxia, in terms of fetal distress, and thereby the neonatal presentation. Institute, or it's a SNCU, it's designing one corner of the unit only for COVID patient, but you have to have a protocols in situ so that everyone is on the same page. There is no confusion when you receive such babies. So we are going to discuss those protocols which we developed in the Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital. Also, every case is going to teach us something. Every time we manage a baby, or every time we receive a baby, we are going to learn something new. And the COVID is actually teaching us a lot of things, from medical to non-medical, a lot of knowledge we are getting. And so team debriefing at the end of each case is extremely important, so that you make the protocol more smoother, and so that we can protect our own people, the healthcare workers, as well as for the safety of the baby. What is also this, that's the first, do no harm. So keep that in mind, and accordingly we have to set in. Also, do not remember whatever the medical management has been done, whatever you're talking to the relatives, because in this situation, in this panic situation, the medical legal issues are likely. But this will depend upon center to center. So we all are well versed with this NRP protocol, which is published by American Academy of Pediatrics in 2000. And now, though it appears a simple NRP protocol, but a lot of done in this protocol, when you go for receiving a baby who is born to a COVID positive mother, I'm going to briefly discuss those protocols. So it starts with antenatal counseling, team briefing, and equipment check. So what is important, there is a resuscitation room. As we all know, we know so many protocols, but it's just a briefing of the protocols. The resuscitation room should be located at least 2 meters or 6 feet away from the delivery table. The room should ideally be a negative pressure room. However, everyone doesn't have that kind of privilege. And we also don't have negative pressure room. So at least a room with AC with 12 air exchanges or with 2 to 4 exofans is absolutely okay. Even if it is not there, doesn't matter. But what matters is social distancing. That is 2 meter distance or 6 feet distance between the mother and the baby. Or you could have a resuscitation corner in a different room, not in the same way the mother is getting delivered. You can have a physical barrier in the form of curtain between the baby and the mother. What is extremely important is a dialogue between the teammates as well as the obstetrician. Now, in this particular situation, obstetrician has to be on the same page. Antenatal counseling is extremely important. The moment they tell you that this is a mother who is going to get delivered, the parents should be counseled. Either you counsel directly wearing a mask and cap and full PPE or maybe partial PPE, or you can do telephonic counseling. What they need to know is that this baby is likely to have a risk of getting neonatal COVID infection. There are certain protocols and there are certain policies the relatives and the mother has to follow after the birth of the baby. The feeding policy should be discussed in detail. However, you don't give the option of giving formula feed. It's only breastfeeding. What needs to be done is give confidence to the parents that breastfeeding is not a contraindication in COVID situation. However, the mother has to take certain precautions, wearing mask and washing hands, etc. If required, NICU admission and the readiness of NICU admission, NICU is also to be shown to them. They need to be told that this is the NICU and here we are going to manage baby in this way. And these are the precautions we'll be taking for the baby. So isolation and discharge policy should also be discussed in detail, because in this situation, it's not us. Even the parents are going to be extremely anxious. So here we need to settle the parents, our teammates, as well as we don't want a lot of exposure to our teammates. So, and even the obstetrician should be on the same page. After this, who should go and attend delivery? So in this particular case, one resuscitator for low-risk delivery, two for high-risk deliveries are extremely important. You have to have a designated donning and doffing area. Once the resuscitator enters, there should not be a confusion donning either karnai ki udhar karnai. There has to be a labeled good donning area and doffing area. However, it has been mentioned, if you take care of aerosol exposure procedures, that is intubation, resuscitation, and a full PPE is must. When there is aerosol exposure is not much, that's feeding and etc., partial PPE is enough. But when you go and attend delivery, full PPE is advised. So once the baby is born, if the baby needs steps of resuscitation with a COVID situation is that you do not do suction. If there are obvious secretions, then only go for suction. Otherwise, there is no need for clearing the secretions. The TPS resuscitator can be used. There are a lot of conflicts whether TPS resuscitator should be used or not be used. However, the benefit of using TPS resuscitator is more compared to we are using TPS resuscitator. The issue is that it should be used. Somebody is doing something on the PPT. Okay. So the only issue is that the set needs to be changed for every baby. It needs to be different. During transport, for the less exposure of the healthcare personnel, we use RAMS cannula as an interface for transfer from the labor room to the NICU or to the isolation room. So that's what we do. Positive pressure ventilation can be given with the TPS resuscitator or with the AMBU bag. However, what we advise is using a two-hand vice grip so that the air leak, the leak is less and the aerosol exposure is less. With full PPE, when you resuscitate a baby, auscultation becomes extremely difficult. If somebody has really attended delivery with full PPE, you will not be able to auscultate. In such situations, we are using ECG to monitor heart rate, and it is easy to monitor a heart rate with using ECG. Whenever it is required, intubation is must, as advised by Dr. Suman Patil. There is no that you prolong intubation and continue with bag and mask ventilation. However, what is important, you cannot send the junior most person for attending delivery. The person who is trained and who is expert in intubation, that person should be there for attending such deliveries. Because here, the principle is you do not want exposure to the healthcare workers or the healthcare workers, and you want safety of the baby as well. While transporting these babies, we use a small incubator-like box, which has been manufactured in Dinanath, and that is used for transporting the baby from the labor room to the NICU or to the mother's room. So this is just a design. What should be done? So this is a simulation model of perinatal management. So there, when a mother is been delivered or she is in OT, the newborn care corner can be in a separate room, or it can be in a 2 meter away or 6 feet away from the mother. You can have a physical barrier between the mother and the baby. Now, this is the box which we use. I'm going to show you. And while using this box, you have to know where which resuscitator is going to stand. That's why I have written there that the one who is going to do PPV is going to be on the left side, one who is going to do the chest compressor should be on the head end, and the one who is going to put an umbilical catheter should be on the right side. And another healthcare worker, that is the person who is going to assist for the transport, should be standing outside the labor room and the resuscitation area, because we do not want this person to get exposed to all the aerosols. So this is just a photograph from our center. We had a designated labor room and designated equipment which you need to keep there. They are not shared with the normal delivery patients. So this is for section. So the mothers are taken for section here, and you kept the resuscitation trolley outside the room. So this is the door. So this is the box which I was talking about. We have labeled this as a neo box. This has been designed in Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, and we use this box for resuscitating a newborn. Now this box is designed in such a way that this part is open. Okay, so even this box can also be used under radiant warmer. This is like a mini incubator. You cannot say it's an incubator, but it can be. It acts as a very good physical barrier. The sisters are pretty confident in managing this baby. Babies who are suspected to confirm COVID-19 under radiant warmer with this box in situ. So in short, what we need to do is physical barrier, that is maintaining distance of 6 feet and 2 meters away. Resuscitation guidelines remain same with few changes only to prevent aerosol exposure. We use box, and there are certain you have to have, based on your center, your setup, you have to have your own protocol of resuscitation. The neonatal transport even system should be ready, and it should be, the protocol should be in place. So this is just a video of what we do. So the baby is delivered, baby is taken. That's the box. We are in partial PP. This is actually just a demo. This is, mother is not COVID. Suspected COVID. Okay. So baby is crying. So the box has been used. I'm standing at the head end. The initial steps have been perform. So the equipment, all equipments are ready, you can see there. Okay, suctioning and etc. So this needs training. When you want to use this box, this definitely needs training. So whenever a baby is going to get admitted, you are going to get babies from three different places. One is your fever OPD, that baby is going to be suspected or confirmed COVID-19. The second is your operation theater, labor room or normal nursery, that's intra-facility transfer, and there's an inter-facility transfer. You have to have a triage system in place, and based on the baby, whether baby is going to be sick or normal. If the baby is going to be normal, baby goes to the isolation room. The isolation rooms, as well as the place where you're going to keep the baby, normal baby with the mother, should also be designated. If the baby is sick, then the baby goes to the COVID designated NICU. So those protocols have to be labeled and set in your unit. So this is a perinatal management. I don't know how do I take out this. Yeah. So this is a flow chart showing how do you go about the investigations and everything. So a baby who is born to a COVID positive mother, if the baby is stable and the mother is suspected of COVID positive mother, the report takes around 24 hours for RT-PCR, and for COVID antigen maybe it's 2 hours, 1 to 2 hours. Now we are doing COVID antigen, it's pretty fast. So if the section is taken and if we know the mother is negative, the baby goes directly with the mother roomed in. And if the mother is positive or mother's results are awaited, still the baby is roomed in with the mother. However, she's been counseled very clearly that you have to wear mask, triple layer mask. You have to maintain social distancing. Feeding doesn't transfer the virus. That you have to counsel. You have to give that much time to the mother. And trust me, we had so far 60 deliveries and we are following this policy. So far, we have not seen any case of postnatal transmission of COVID with this policy. So if mother is positive, again rooming in. If at all they are not willing for rooming in, they are willing for isolation, then you have to do accordingly what the parents need, what the parents want. So if the baby is sick, baby is definitely going to go to the COVID designated NICU. If the mother is negative, then the baby goes to the normal NICU. The baby, if the mother is positive, then we preserve placenta, because if and we swab the fetal surface of the placenta, we also send the baby's nasopharynx for the COVID-19 PCR, or nowadays we started with the antigen testing. So if the baby is positive, then we send placenta for immunohistochemistry to see whether there is any transplacental transfer or no. If the baby is negative and asymptomatic, baby goes to the mother, like a normal routine care, or a normal NICU if baby is sick. If the baby is positive, baby is cared in COVID designated NICU. This is a perinatal management of a baby who is born to a COVID positive or suspected mother. We have certain policies of NICU admission, COVID admission of newborns in COVID NICU. So all babies who are symptomatic needing NICU admission but confirm COVID-19, they go to the COVID NICU. Those who are suspected, that is babies born to mothers whose reports are awaited but they are symptomatic and mothers are positive, or babies with symptoms like SARI or sepsis or fever needing NICU admission, and with history of exposure in the form of travel or contact, those babies are admitted in COVID designated NICU. So what do we do? Once the babies are admitted in NICU, the transport is done using the box so that the aerosol exposure during the transport is less. If the baby is stable, baby is managed as I showed in the picture, the baby is managed in neo box under radiant warmer. Now, these babies are the babies with hypoglycemia, hyperbili. If the baby is unstable and has either respiratory distress or shock or requiring any kind of respiratory support, so we do not defer any kind of respiratory support for the symptomatic COVID positive babies. What is different is that you use the viral filter at the expiratory limb when you start CPAP or NIPP or invasive ventilation for these babies. What is important is that suction is not recommended. If there is a need for suction, then continuous suction is advised or open toileting is advised. So standard NICU protocol should be continued. They don't change in at home. If the mother is in the same household, she should maintain a distance of 6 feet or 2 meters. And she can handle the baby if she is afebrile for 72 hours without use of antipyretics, or at least 7 days have passed since symptoms first appeared. Other caregivers who are suspected case of COVID should also follow the precautions. They should use the mask, they should follow the hand hygiene, they should follow the principle of social distancing. COVID positive neonate who are in NICU, the discharge criteria are same as NICU discharge criteria. They should first satisfy the normal NICU discharge criteria. They should be symptom free and able to maintain saturation for consecutive 3 days, and then close monitoring or isolation is advised for next 7 days. So after this, discussing this basic protocol, I'll go to the one case. That's first we managed this case in August first week. It's a 27-year-old primary Ayurveda mother. She was referred at 32 weeks of gestation. She was not in labor. She was referred from deranged Dopplers. There was a fetal distress. An emergency section was taken. She was asymptomatic. However, because she was likely to go in premature labor because of the high blood pressure, her COVID test was done. The baby was born through meconium stain amniotic fluid. Remember, 32 weeks baby born through meconium stain amniotic fluid. Baby required extensive resuscitation, including chest compressions and medications. So the protocol which we had set that was followed strictly. The baby was transferred to NICU. Now this is just a video of Lisa, but this is just to show you how we intubate in neobox. So again, this is me. So husband was counseled in detail before delivery. Team briefing was done. Baby was resuscitated. Transport incubator was used and the NICU was kept ready. Because when there is no patient in COVID designated NICU and then suddenly you get some call like this, then you have to tell your nursing staff that we want a bed, a ventilator needs to be arranged. Because donning the staff donning, going to the NICU and setting up everything needs around 15 to 20 minutes. So that was also done. So this is how we use the, so it's easy, but it needs training. You cannot use, when you buy the, you prepare some box like this, and if you try to intubate in first hand, it's going to be a failure. If you want to use this, this definitely needs training. So this is a LISA procedure, which I'm just showing you. The intubation is possible with the box. So this baby's X-ray was not suggestive of RDS, was not suggestive of meconium aspiration syndrome. However, there was some haziness here and here, which was seen. The baby was intubated. Baby required high frequency nitric. Baby was kept under radiant warmer with the neo box and was managed. Baby had pneumothorax. The ICD was inserted at 48 hours of life. Baby's clinical condition deteriorated. So these were the baby's investigations. So you can see the hemoglobin was low. The platelets started dropping. The baby had absolute lymphopenia. There was neutrophilia. The first blood gas showed asphyxia. And the next blood gas was suggestive. You can see the OI and PF ratio. Very bad PF ratio. Very bad OI. So this baby was on high frequency and nitric. And CRP and procalcitonin was on higher side. You can see that the FDP was raised. It was 905. Interleukin 6 was more than 200. PTA-PTT was mildly deranged. Blood culture was consistently sterile. This baby's COVID PCR was positive, which was tested within 24 hours of life. We had sent baby's endotracheal secretions for COVID. And the repeat test at 96 hours of life was also tested positive. So this baby was a case of likely vertical transmission or transplacental transfer. And the investigations were suggestive of cytokine storm syndrome. So Dr. Amol wanted me to talk about neonatal multisystem inflammatory syndrome. So actually not very much described, but if you put everything together in this situation, this baby had myocardial dysfunction. This baby also had the COVID test was positive, and the lab parameters were positive for raised inflammatory markers. So this baby manifested like NMIS. Have not been reported for NMIS. We know a lot of about PIMS and MISC, etc., which we will be discussing. So in this particular situation, if you see the investigations, you can see here the OI on So the PF ratio on day 5 was 95, then it was 85, and then it increased to 233. So because baby's condition was not improving on day 3, day 4, day 5, I was not able to wean the nitric, and I was not able to wean the high frequency with the raised inflammatory markers. Here we started baby on steroids. So after starting steroids, I could gradually wean the nitric. I could gradually wean the high frequency, and you can see the improvement in the respiratory condition. The baby improved. Baby was extubated to CPAP. This is baby CT scan. Now we don't do, it is not advised to do CT scan in newborns. We don't do it. However, the parents were very pro. They were counseled from day one that the baby has asphyxia. Baby has likely to have neuromorbidity in future. They wanted to see the extent of COVID pneumonia in this particular patient. That's why CT scan was done. It showed hyaline membrane disease. You can see it doesn't correlate with the X-ray or the baby's prematurity. So this was COVID-19 pneumonia. And so in view of overall picture and the neuromorbidity, the care was withdrawn in this baby. This baby responded to steroids. Baby was extubated, but the care was withdrawn later on. So dilemma while treating this newborn was whether RT-PCR or rapid antigen. So RT-PCR remains the standard of care. Rapid antigen you can do because you get the reports early. However, when there is a suspicious that this baby is likely to have COVID or the high chance of COVID, then the RT-PCR should be done. Role of antivirals. So there's no role of antiviral in newborns. First of all, there's no data. Second, these are not safe in the neonatal age. The safety data is also not available. Plasma therapy, no role. It is doubtful in adults itself. So newborns, there's no role. Role of immunomodulators, no. Role of steroids, if you see the data which is available in newborns, it is clearly mentioned there is no role of steroids. However, now the cases have been reported. Now Pune also reported 2-3 cases. The role varies case by case, and based on the case and the severity, you need to decide. So in this particular patient, the baby was not improving, deterioration was there, as well as there was raised inflammatory markers. We used steroids. Now again, there is a dilemma in using which steroid, what dose for particular newborns. So dexamethasone, if I use 0.15 mg per kg daily for 10 days or 7 days, is going to be a huge dose for the newborn. It is going to affect the neurodevelopment. So this particular patient, I use DART regimen, which we use for BPD, and the babies responded to that DART regimen. So we really don't know what dose, which steroids, but dexa appears to be favorite of all physicians and pediatricians so far. Role of anticoagulation, limited data in neonates. It's case-to-case basis. However, low molecular weight heparin is preferred. Indication is intubated patients with sudden clinical deterioration, ST of pulmonary embolism, or physical findings consistent with thrombosis. Patients with respiratory failure with high levels of D-dimer, that is 4 times normal upper limit, should be considered for anticoagulation. So my take-home message, pandemic is not over, though Pune is settling in terms of COVID infection. It is not yet over. And what is important is you need to prepare and develop the protocol for managing such patients which best suits to your unit. Do no harm. That's the principle we need to follow. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a very nice session, and the messages were to the point. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So the one thing that is the innovative box, that new box that you have made.
Yes.
So you are quite quick to make that, and I think we should also follow this type of. We can also make this. So that was also a very nice innovation and a nice message to us. And I told you to speak about NMIS, okay, only because we are seeing some cases of NMIS in Kolhapur also. And so we treated a few of these cases, and the treatment is not mentioned anywhere.
No.
So we have to ask the people who have treated, who are experienced. So there was one question. This box, chat box.
No, I can't hear.
Okay, which antibody is your? Voice is not clear.
Okay,
this here.
Can't hear.
Can you hear me now?
No.
Can you hear me now?
No.
Amol mobile zara jawal gaya.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. So which antibodies are you doing, like IgG, IgM? What you are doing for this?
So we have two antibodies available, IgG and total antibody.
Okay.
So we are not doing antibodies so far. Not done. We are doing but one patient I did, that was IgG.
Okay.
If you want to diagnose, yes.
Yeah, diagnose. Yeah. One more thing is that about use of steroids. Which steroids you have used?
So we use dexamethasone for this. Yeah, we use dexamethasone. This baby was very small. Newborn is a different population. So talking about steroids, so far whatever data, normal steroids also we use in newborns. We have the data about dexamethasone and hydrocortisone to some extent. Using methylprednisolone is very heavy steroid for newborns. And when we treat newborns, it's not life. We have to take care of the quality of life also. So saving becomes equally important, but that baby should also have a good neurodevelopmental outcome. So thinking about everything for this particular patient, we use DART.
Okay. And about heparin, madam, use of anticoagulants. So what is your experience, and when did you use it, or?
No, I haven't used for newborns.
Okay. So because there are few cases that we have seen where the D dimers were quite high.
Yes.
So we were in dilemma whether to use or not. So we used with a minimum dose of low molecular weight heparin and subcutaneous. I don't know what helps or what doesn't. So what are the investigations that we usually should do? So should we follow the adults or pediatrics?
We should follow the pediatric data for the investigations, that is normal CBC, and basically to show the severity of illness and the inflammatory markers. So and also to document some kind of serositis. So CBC, we do interleukin 6 also, D-dimers, ferritin, LDH. You can do LFTs, CREAT, and blood culture is extremely important in such situation, because diagnosing a baby with systemic with the cytokine storm syndrome like feature, they're going to present like sepsis. Now the question here comes, like, if your FDP or the D-dimers are raised, whether it is really a COVID-associated coagulopathy or it is a TIC because of the sepsis. Because we we see so many sepsis negative culture negative sepsis. So in that particular cases, I think along with everything, fibrinogen level will also help you in differentiating these two parameters. If your fibrinogen levels are high, it is likely COVID-associated coagulopathy.
About the COVID positive symptomatic babies, madam, that one baby you have managed. So whether we are managing a prematurity related complications or COVID related complication, how in this case you had sent cultures and they were positive. You had sent
they were negative.
You had sent this RT-PCR of the ET.
Yes.
That was negative. That was positive or negative? That
was RT-PCR was positive.
Yeah. So this is a dilemma again. See whether we are. Yeah. Okay. So that was a nice messages. I will just see the chat box. There is one question from Dr. Neelam Belekar. NNF recommends testing for neonates of COVID positive mother within 24 hours and after 5 days. Is it necessary to do a day 5 test who is still now asymptomatic?
Not needed, because that was an old protocol that was published in April, and many things have changed. Because a baby who is likely to come positive after day 5, that baby is likely to come positive during 28 days anytime. So there is no need. Only if the baby is symptomatic, then only you test the baby.
So the same question was asked by Dr. Ajay Shastri, whether how to differentiate between viremia phase and cytokine phase.
Viremia phase and cytokine phase.
Yeah.
I think cytokine phase is very clear that you have all the cytokine syndrome. Okay. And viremia phase, if you want to differentiate, you have to do a cord blood PCR, blood PCR, if you really want to see viremia. And generally, cytokine phase is post-viral. So if you have inflammatory markers which are raised, then it is likely that you are getting that dysregulation, cytokine dysregulation of the cytokine phase.
Okay. And one more question was that how to treat the febrile inflammatory phase, inflammatory syndrome, MSIC.
Same for the neonates.
That's same we have there.
For the
neonates. So, madam, almost you have covered everything. So, thank you very much for this covering everything in this short span. And thank you very much for giving your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Over to you, Prasanna sir.
Thank you, madam.